Hello, everyone. Oh, very great show so far. I'm really excited to be here today to share my thoughts on this concept of a world or a future without borders. I think it's when I started to think about that subject, the first thought I had was, wow, that's a very vast subject. How I'm going to approach this. It's almost like I have to do a talk about infinity. And then I realized that a little bit like the hyper-connected world we live in, infinity can scare us. It did scare me as how to approach this subject. And it seemed natural as a fear because we seem to be exposed to the opposite the day we were born. After all, like parenthood is all about setting clear boundaries, not the other way around. I remember it like it was yesterday. My second child, Raphael, was still a baby at the time. And wouldn't stop playing with that box. You know, one of those boxes with shape holes in it, and you have to put the same shape in the same hole. He had really no idea what he was doing with that. The only thing he could do was noise. That's why I remember it so clearly. He would hit stuff, shake the shapes, make noise about it, like didn't know what he was doing. Until one moment where he, by accident, put the right shape in the right hole, and he paused. He turned around and looked at me. He was so proud, his eyes were glowing, but he couldn't say anything to me. So it's almost like I could see in his eyes that he wanted to say something like, "Dad, I think I'm a fucking genius." And I just was happy for him. And he started being overly excited, so he took another shape, started to hit in the same hole, trying to put it in, but it didn't work, and it didn't work. So he got angry and more angry, and he paused again. Looked at me and started to scream like there was no tomorrow. And then he threw the toys really far away, didn't want to come back to it. It's funny when you think about it, how is discovery created expectations? It's almost like it reduced his ability to explore in a split of a second. That's very human. We're extremely good at that, putting barriers in our own minds in order to forge our own thoughts. Our own beliefs. We think we understand something, but sometimes it's just a barrier we put in ourselves to believe in our ideas. That's something I need to do all the time if I want to be convincing with people. I had countless bears discussion that convinced me that the future of our industry is a fascinating subject. But too often, those discussions circle around those kinds of boundaries we put in our minds. A few examples. Questions like how technology will bring games to the next level, or how the cloud will revolutionize the way we play games, or even what's the place of mobile devices in our industry. These are all relevant questions, really relevant questions. But they're kind of beside the point. They all suggest being very reactive towards technology. The thing is, from my perspective, technology is not what defines our future. People's are. Their ideas, their minds, their culture. That's what's shaping our industry. It's up to us to push our medium beyond its technology, not the other way around. The way I see it, I like to think of game as a way to ignite people's sense of wonder, both for those who create it and those who play it. After all, it kind of starts with a simple idea. And then it grows from one great mind to another. And with a little bit of luck, it can become something spectacular. Then, if well executed, it can continue to grow in the player's mind. And it starts perceiving things that are not there in the first place. Players start considering elements that you didn't consider as a creator. That's why I like to see games a bit like a music instrument. It's something that, you know, when you build an instrument, no doubt that everybody who works on it has an impact on the way it's going to feel, the way it's going to sound. But it also comes with this inevitability that there will be space for the user, an input that will scale that amount of possibilities to infinity. That's what I feel it's like to reach a world without borders. A music instrument is kind of open to interpretation. It's kind of borderless. And that's really what I like about games, or at least that's always what I thought I liked about games. It's just that when I was a kid, I didn't know exactly, precisely that fact. Back then, 27 years ago or so, I think, my Final Fantasy avatar was just made of a few pixels. It didn't bother me at all, actually. In my mind, it was the most badass knights and mages that I could think of. But as technology moved forward, Squaresoft's ability to execute was more and more precise. And this is where I realized that these guys weren't the most masculine fellow on the planet, or at least that's the way I perceived it. As they were better using technology, suddenly it's like they were closing the gap between what they wanted to achieve and what I was perceiving. And I got less and less interested because the game was less and less open to my interpretation. Now, don't get me wrong here, I'm not bashing on technology, far from it. I think technology is awesome. It gives us the force to achieve what we want to express ourselves more fluidly. It's just that sometimes it's one of those examples that you put in your mind, and it could cloud your ability to see beyond their inevitable limitations. I feel like that's beyond those limitations, that a world without borders can exist. You know, I talk to a lot of people in the business, whether it's creators, like businessmen, and I never really met someone who didn't want to take risk in this industry. I don't think it exists that much. It's not about desire. It's just that when you start building a product, it has a lot of people involved. When you start collecting and combining all the barriers they put in their minds, their fear, their belief, it becomes one hell of a puzzle to achieve something that's risky and different. There's a lot of communications involved. When you look back at it, technology helps us to create stuff that are beautiful. We're getting really good at executing characters, for example. But I can't help but sometimes say to myself, so what? It's beautiful, but what's the second degree in all of this? I think that as we develop new ways to achieve very complex things more precisely, just like building characters, we also need new problems to challenge ourselves to go forward. It's almost like we need to build the eight vice characters of today. Find something so crazily difficult to do and inspiring, and try to do the first iteration of that. Let it open to interpretation so people can actually go beyond what you ever thought of it. And then maybe it can bring us to the next level. You need to find those things, I think, and strategically put them into your games, calculating risk, of course. You don't need to reinvent everything all the time. But still, if you put some of those things, then you can ignite, I think, a little bit more of the sense of wonder into players and into its creators. That's kind of the, really humbly, that's kind of the stuff we tried to do with Watch Dogs. We had crazy sentences like control an entire city or monitor everybody in an entire city. Go to their privacy. It sounded crazy and impossible at first. But the goal was to try and identify the barriers in each mind and see if we could actually find simple solutions to do a step forward in that direction. I said it earlier. It feels a little bit more like the hyper-connected world we live in. That's the way I see it. You start by pitching something to a team, which of course you've exchanged with them a lot. But no matter how hard you exchange and you talk to them, you cannot avoid the inevitable, which is everybody you're gonna talk to, whether they're inside or outside the team, they're gonna forge their own perception of what you're pitching, especially if it's a new IP, a new product, something that's based on nothing, or at least we like to think it this way. They're gonna use what they know of games, what they think, they're gonna put their own barriers of it. And now you're in front of an infinity of perception gaps. And you can either try to fix that problem, but that's not gonna happen. I think you have to embrace that fact. Everybody's different. You can sit back, find the proper connection between you and other people's, and start to learn from that instead of always saying what you want. How can you do that? I think one of the main things that I've learned is you need to listen. We talked a lot about trust earlier on, and I think that was a really interesting twist on it. The way I see it, it's often, even if you're really good in convincing and talking, sometimes you go back home and you won a debate that you shouldn't have won. You just won it out of skills because you out-debated the other person. But then when you sleep on it, sometimes because I talk a lot, I tend to have flashback of the discussion, and I start listening only after the guy's gone, which kind of suck when you think about it. And then you come back the other day, and you're like, oh, I shouldn't have won that battle. I'm going to go and see that guy again. Let's talk again. And now I'm going to listen to what he has to say. I remember when I was a level design director back on Far Cry 2, I was always saying the same thing to level designers, but it took me a while to then afterwards practice what I was preaching to them. I was saying to them, if there's one thing you need to be good at, make sure you're able to tell me why you're doing what you're doing. Because if you don't, then I don't know where you're aiming at. And there's a good chance I'm going to ask you to redo your work constantly. But the thing is, and the sad part is, most of the time, that's probably going to be based on the wrong reasons, simply because I don't know what you're trying to achieve. So we cannot align our visions together. Now that I am a creative director, I'm supposed to be really good at explaining the why of things. But it's not that easy. And I just discovered that talking is not the way to go. You want to listen instead. At the very beginning of Watch Dogs, a lot of people, of course, back then it was nothing. It was just a blank page, new project, exciting, ambitious stuff. And a lot of people would pick my brain just to know if they wanted to join in or not, just to know what kind of ideas I would have. I heard all sorts of things during those conversations. I remember one really clearly that is kind of a in-your-face example of what I'm talking about. We were talking about the importance of vehicles in a contemporary open city game. Because of games like GTA and everything, like, can you really release a game where you cannot get in the cars and start driving them? Very simple discussion. But then at some point, he paused and he said to me, oh, I have a solution. Let's do a driving game. Let's not get out of the car. We cannot get out of the car. Like, well, you're not even in a project yet. Like, we didn't even start. We're almost finishing debugging Far Cry 2. Why we shouldn't consider that option? And he said to me, because GTA is doing it. So I paused, and I said, well, that sucks. That means we have another problem. He said, why? He said, we cannot drive either. And he asked me why we cannot drive. I said, because Need for Speed is doing it. So let's not do a game and go back home. So in the end, that's a very obvious discussion where you see someone is stuck with something. And it's not always that obvious. But I think that's a good example to start the ball. Some examples are more complicated. Sometimes you have something within the content of the game that you pitch that get people obsessed. They start wanting to put ideas only in that stuff. And now you fail to find something new. So yes, I did remove guns from the concept of Watch Dogs really early in the process. It kind of shows in the end game, actually. I knew it would come back, but that I didn't need to tell the team, not at the time. It was just an exercise. And it ended up like helping the team push for stuff like hacking and the idea of profiling people around you, being more subtle, walking around. It created all sorts of new experiences that we thought wouldn't be possible just because people stopped to think about awesome new ways of using guns as a mechanic. And then when we felt it was safe, we could bring it back because, to be quite frank, I felt that a contemporary open world needed that kind of mechanics, especially for the enemies. At least that's my take on it. More and more I got into the creative direction of Watch Dogs, I realized that I was spending most of my time trying to identify the word to never use. Because some loaded terms sometimes create a bombshells where you stop controlling what kind of stuff you're doing. And what I mean by loaded terms like this, like one example would be something like a word like superheroes. It's like a box, a very complex box that you give to people. But then suddenly you don't know which superhero they like, you don't know which styles they like. Like it comes with all sorts of endless tones to it. It becomes a facilitator. It's a barrier in your brain that you understand. It's comforting. Superheroes, we understand what you're doing. We're done. Instead of digging beyond the terms, and trying to think about stuff like, do we want to go vigilantism? What does it mean to be a vigilante in the real world? What are the stuff that we want to do instead of what superhero is? That was kind of the first one that I decided to just remove to help people dig into what they wanted to do. Second one, surprisingly, is cyberpunk. I hated that word for a very long time. People would spontaneously make the shortcut in the team. Oh, we're cyberpunk. How about robots? Those kind of stuff. But we were not that, and everybody knew it. It's just that they wanted to put it in a box. As soon as we started to accept that we couldn't use that term, then we started to think more about cyberpunk as catching up with reality, we started to inspire ourselves a lot more from the news and what's possible to act instead of seeing the fiction that was already been done. And the last but not the least term that I wanted to remove was realism. That one was closer to what we wanted to do. Watch Dogs wanted to be some kind of a dramatic experience where people could relate with what was going on. The thing is, if I say to the team or if everybody says we're realistic, it means nothing and everything at the same time. It can also mean first degree interpretation of the word, which might not give us what we want. So we ended up with stuff like make it more Michael Mann and less Michael Bay, which is very different than saying realism. But it didn't mean something. It mean, can you convey as a director, as animation, or anything you do, the drama of the situation you play? Yes, and what are the tools to make you do it more? Then that means you can cross the boundaries of realistic to achieve that goal. That's the kind of stuff a Michael Mann movie do. Not quite a Michael Bay movie. Both are valid, but that was kind of our take on it. Now, the funny thing is when you look back at E3 2012, all of the elements that we've removed from our vocabulary was quite apparent in the demo. In fact, when we started to talk to the press, it's like I was getting spit every word I hated back in my face all the time. But I was fine with it, because it was not coming from us, it was coming from them. And that's an interesting distinction. I realized over time, because I was puzzled with how many different angles people would describe Watch Dogs, that actually they were taking part of what they loved, and they were kind of sharing it to us, saying, there's something I can relate to in your game. I like that part, I like cyberpunk, so I think it is a cyberpunk extravaganza, so I'm gonna write about that. And then when you read the article, you can tell that they like this part, but they don't know quite what's this thing yet. And I like to think that it's part of the reasons why it got appealing. It was not quite a box. It was not cyberpunk. It was not a realistic game. It was just a little bit of all those things, plus a little je ne sais quoi that people don't understand. So we got back with that learning. And of course, I could talk about the entire project of Watch Dogs, but as you know, that's been a very long journey. That would be an endless talk. So we got back and started to do a lot more playtests, and a lot of the production started to scale up to the point where we shipped the game. And the one few things that we've seen that made us smile a lot are some of the elements that we thought were those differentiators. Like, for example, we saw a lot of people spend way too much time taking screenshots of profiling information of people, which for those who don't know are completely random, combined with situations that they created, and that created them stories that they like. Simple example of that would be a guy dead in a car after a car crash, and then you profile him and it says recently survived a car crash. People would love those kind of situations, starting to fill the gaps between things, creating stories out of thin air. So in some way they were taking incomplete stuff and they were filling it in. Started to take their own stories inside the game, if you want. The way people were invading other players as well was getting more and more creative. They started to blend in, creating features that don't really exist. That's a pattern that every game developer sees all the time. To me, that's what the 8-byte characters are in Watch Dogs. Profiling, hacking people, invading everyone's privacy, even other players. Are they perfect? Absolutely not. They are not. They're way too hard to achieve the first time, or at least I'm not that good. The thing I do like is the team managed to push all of those things together by slowly removing their barriers, and they teach a lot through that to me. And we all learn together to make something that players seems to have liked to express themselves with in a different way. Most people didn't talk about the stuff they already played. We didn't see much ways of exploring yourself with guns or those elements. Not that they don't belong in the game, but it does mean that we've put a lot of effort into something that seems to matter. I'd like to think that some of Watch Dogs is borderless, is kind of a music instrument. It's not a perfect one, but at least people are expressing themselves with it. They're thinking about potentially the games of tomorrow. So when I think about a future without borders for our industry, the way I see it is I feel like in my 15 years in the industry, there's always been a lot more people who talk than people who listen. People don't pay attention to the barriers each other puts into themselves. And no matter how great your intentions are at the beginning, how often you started a project that had all the most innovative ideas in the world and ended up doing something very similar to everything else you've done at the end, just because of those barriers. So I think opening our minds to that would be a great step forward. And a lot of people are doing that already. I would say that every aspect of the industry could open their minds a bit more. If there's something a bit new about a game, that would be great that everybody else recognizes it. Because we're not that good at doing that. We're really good at looking at the similar stuff. But there's a lot of game out there who are really, really innovative in some way or another. The way I see it, there's a lot of players out there who are playing all the games we're doing. I mean, they are the game developers of tomorrow. So I think it is our responsibility to give them something. So they'd not just play our game and say, look, I just bought this console, and show to their friend how powerful this console is right now. If we do our job properly, they should start dreaming about the game they're going to be playing 20 years from now. I think it's our responsibility to give them a reason to then become a game developer and go far beyond the borders we created for themselves. Thank you very much.